Donnell Hornet is by no means the most expensive plane in the Navy inventory. Rather, it represents an attempt to find a high-performance, value-for-money solution to two very different Navy requirements. The F-18 brilliantly succeeds in filling those needs. But, good as the design is, the plane almost never happened. In many ways, its story can be traced back to the early 1950s. This was at the time when the Cold War had been a reality for several years. Another reality that the US was coming to terms with was that the Russians were no longer lagging behind America in aeronautical design. In fact, they had achieved remarkable developments in the post-war years and were able to produce a series of bomber designs which shocked the NATO allies every bit as much as their MiG fighters had done. This is the Russian Tu-16, NATO named the Badger. An extremely advanced aircraft for its time, powered by only two engines, engines that were the largest and most powerful jets of their day. The Badger's full-swept wing, high speed and substantial bomb load made it a major threat, but its limited range would have confined it to use only in the event of a European conflict. No such constraint applied to the Tu-95, the Bear. This design was to prove an excellent investment for the Soviet military, its sole user for over 30 years. Its jet-driven propeller provided fuel economy, which enhanced its range to reach North America from Russian bases. But it was the M4 Bison, whose existence was discovered in the late 1950s, which constituted far more of a strategic threat. The Bison combined the speed of a pure jet with the range of the Bear. Unknown to the Western planners, the M4 was not built in the large numbers of its propeller-driven counterpart, though their concern at its capabilities were well-founded. A fast, high-flying target like the Bison called for a different type of weapon than had previously been used in fighters, air-to-air rockets. Non-guided rockets were fitted to the fighters of the day, which were designed for high speed and high climb, with some also designed to offer particularly long range and all-weather capability. Thus, the early Super Sabres, Delta Daggers and some Voodoos, together with Northrop Scorpions, all in their time used basic rocketry, dedicated to the purpose of responding to the perceived threat from the Russians. If conflict had ever come, large numbers of jet fighters from Air Defense Command would have used thousands of rockets to provide a wall of destruction before the new Russian designs. As technology progressed, so did rocketry, and the mass of simple, unguided weapons gave way to a limited number of much larger and more sophisticated concepts. Missiles were now guided, and some even contained nuclear warheads, to be fired far ahead of the launching fighter to create a nuclear barrier, far worse than conventional rockets. The aircraft that carried this technology had to be fast and high-flying. But its purpose of intercepting the bombers meant that it would not necessarily be light and manoeuvrable, and certainly that it would not be a fighter in the traditional terms that would have been understood even a decade before. This commitment to producing an aircraft that would be known as an interceptor rather than a dogfighter was to leave the Air Force deficient when the conflict in Southeast Asia arose. Delta Daggers were ideally suited to protecting American airstrips and other installations from North Vietnamese bombers. But during the entire campaign, no such attack took place, and the 102s were suited to no other purpose. Vietnam was a different war, and the aircraft that the US Air Force would confront were nearer to the older definition of fighters, highly mobile, adequately fast, and economic. In some ways, they were almost primitive. However, against Western technology, North Vietnamese MiGs gave a very good account of themselves in a dogfight scenario. The most successful US fighter in the conflict was the F-4 Phantom. Very fast and extremely powerful, it used several levels of guided missilery and a second crew member to assist in their firing in a combination that was to prove the best the US could offer against the agile MiGs. But the F-4 was originally designed as a Navy interceptor, using missilery to deal with enemy planes, rather than being able to take them on as a true dogfighter itself. Even before the conclusion of the Southeast Asian War, the Navy, in light of the revealed limitations of the F-4 in fighter-to-fighter combat, was looking for a more versatile interceptor, which it found in the Grumman F-14 Tomcat. With the Tomcat, no expense was spared. Carrier space is limited, and it was thought it must be dedicated to the best money could buy, which undoubtedly the Tomcat was. It used variable sweep wings to provide flexible combinations, and despite its size, it was extremely agile. Using the Phoenix missile, it achieved a range the Air Force had only been able to contemplate for many years. Because of the Tomcat's flexible design, it was able to carry the same type of weaponry the Phantom used over Vietnam, with the significant inclusion of a cannon for close encounters and dogfighting. Where the Navy went for a multi-purpose replacement for the F-4, the US Air Force decided to build a new, dedicated air superiority fighter. For this role, McDonnell Douglas developed the F-15 Eagle. With a more defined mission, the Eagle didn't require the second crew member of the Tomcat or a variable sweep wing, but had to combine enormous speed and range with agility and a heavy firepower. The F-15 Eagle is today still probably the best single fighter concept available anywhere. Fighter design is as much a question of philosophy as it is technology, and Russian thinking had taken another tack entirely. Their defense hinged upon large numbers of clever, if perhaps basic, planes like the MiG-21. This aircraft had earned great credit over Vietnam, and still to this day, supplied in quantity, provides value for money as a fighter. Opposing this was a US philosophy of striving to achieve the highest quality. But the sheer numbers of Russian fighters caused the US to think about its designs again. A further influence on US thinking in the early 70s was that many of the supporting NATO air forces were flying the Lockheed 104 Starfighter, a plane that had proven very effective but was now fast nearing retirement. the Starfighter never sold in large numbers to the US Air Force. But, as a lightweight, value-for-money concept, not unlike the Russian MiGs, the 104 was manufactured abroad in large numbers by many of the US allies. This revealed a large market, which all the leading Western manufacturers were hoping to fill. The French, with their Mirage F1E, offered a sophisticated lightweight fighter that could well have replaced the 104 as a value-for-money plane. Similarly, the Swedish Saab Drakon was put forward in a very effective high-tech answer to NATO's needs. The Drakon was a brilliant design, but both the two European concepts would have to do battle with US manufacturers. General Dynamics had been out of the fighter business for some time, and they were determined to get not only overseas orders from NATO countries looking for a replacement for the Starfighter, but to fill what was fast becoming seen as America's need for a more economical fighter than the F-15. The new plane would need to be purchased in the sort of numbers that the Soviets were known to be deploying, and the combined markets clearly justified the manufacturer investing millions in its new design. General Dynamics' entry into the competition was the F-16 Fighting Falcon. The prototype F-16 differed very little externally from those that were to follow. Right from the very beginning, the project went beyond the state of the art to technology that was still on the threshold of development, like a total commitment to fly-by-wire flight controls. Despite the predominance of large US jet fighters, there'd always been a school of thought which advocated the virtues of lighter designs, like the F-104 Starfighter. A later design, the Northrop T-38 Talon supersonic jet trainer, demonstrated the philosophy of light versus might using two small jet engines in a thoroughly efficient airframe. The T-38 was a clever, economical and simple design which Northrop offered the Air Force as a tool to train its fighter pilots before they went solo. The soundness of the basic design can be seen in this spectacular spin testing of the prototype. It was probably not surprising, given the availability of such a proven and successful airframe as the high-performance trainer, that its manufacturers were tempted to develop a dedicated single-seat fighter version, which became the F-5 Tiger. This aircraft's relatively low cost and high performance developed many foreign sales, although, like the Starfighter, it had not done particularly well in the US inventory. However, overall, the US and European markets for fighters had provided a windfall for Northrop. The company continued to develop the F-5 shape to provide even more maneuverability, and in the process extended the area where the forward section of the wing joined the fuselage into a forward strake. The product of sophisticated fuselage development, the forward strake concept, together with some other T-38 legacies like the commitment to two light engines, was, in the early 1970s, to be incorporated in Northrop's next design, the F-17 Cobra. The Cobra was larger than the F-5 and offered many other advances, like the twin fin concept. But the model's lineage was still quite distinct, and Northrop hoped that the design, together with the company's proven experience with overseas clients and a wealth of knowledge gained in producing lightweight planes, would make it the winner in the fighter competition. The company canvassed the NATO Air Forces heavily with the prospect of buying this new aircraft. As you can see from this footage, pilot comfort and high tech came together in the plane's interior. Although in some ways it was still behind the F-16, in that its flight control at this stage was not fully committed to fly-by-wire. If Northrop could obtain a high proportion of the potential overseas sales of the new fighter, its factory in California would be able to retool after the end of F-5 production. Like General Dynamics, they hoped their plane would carry off the order for the crystallizing US Air Force requirement. In April 1974, the press, dignitaries and members of the military were brought together to see the YF-17. Much was at stake, but Northrop had good reason to be confident on that sunny Californian day when the plane was first unveiled for the public that their aircraft would at least get substantial sales. The contracts were fast building up to be the biggest peacetime Western fighter deal of all time, because by now, both the estimates of NATO allies and the US Air Force had been revised upwards. As is often the way in US military procurement, the two US contenders would first have to compete, one alongside the other, in a vigorous fly-off competition where the planes would be tested to their limits. When, at Edwards Air Force Base in California, Northrop and General Dynamics pitted the genius of each company's engineering teams against one another, the outcome was clearly going to be close. Both aircraft handled superbly, but at the end of the day, General Dynamics got the US Air Force contract with its Fighting Falcon. The one engine of the F-16, though a more expensive plant than the F-17's, had advantages of commonality, as the same engine was already in use in the F-15, and therefore, service skills and spare parts were already available. Long before the fly-off, General Dynamics had committed their company to production preparations in a massive gamble that they would actually win the day. This itself became a critical factor in the outcome, as it meant that they were able to promise delivery of their aircraft much earlier than their competitors. The Cobra had shown some shortcomings, in that its air brake, shown here, was thought to be less than fully effective, and there were some concerns about its range. There's no doubt that, coming from a long line of light fighters, the Northrop plane was a superb aircraft. But, with the economy of scale that General Dynamics would enjoy with their Air Force order, the Fighting Falcon scooped the pool for local and export markets as well. The F-17 was relegated to the pages of the history books. Just one more design that didn't quite make it. The final card that General Dynamics had played to gain its European orders was offering NATO countries a large share of the aircraft's production for their local industries in a complicated offset deal. This meant that much of the technology that had been developed at General Dynamics' Fort Worth plant found itself being used in Holland, Belgium and other European countries to produce identical aircraft thousands of miles apart. Further exploiting its advantage, General Dynamics proceeded with more sales outside the NATO bloc. Here the Iranian symbol is placed on an F-16, though due to the turmoil in that country it would, in the end, be delivered to Israel. Fighting Falcons were also developed into very successful ground attack aircraft, as well as dedicated fighters. Here, a pair of F-16s are shown in service with the Egyptian Air Force. This Danish twin-seat version demonstrates the agility of General Dynamics' high-tech solution to the lightweight fighter and attack requirement. Although the US and NATO air forces had found an answer to their problems, the US Navy had to live with different parameters. By now, the F-14 Tomcats had been in service for some time, and these superb aircraft were clearly doing their job well. But their high-cost technology was a cause of concern for the Navy. Another problem the Navy had to contend with was that the A-7 Corsair II attack aircraft were nearing the end of their service life. In its time, this design had been very successful. Developed from a dedicated fighter, the A-7 Corsair II had seen considerable action over Vietnam in a strike bomber role, with unflagging and unchallenged efficiency. But now, as the 1980s approached, and with many years of service on their wings, a replacement was needed. Third concern was that some F-4 Phantoms, many in service with the Marines, were still flying in roles where it would be uneconomic for Tomcats to replace. Confronted with these three influences, the Navy too needed an economical alternative. But there was no way it could consider the single-engine F-16, with its lightweight undercarriage, a suitable answer. As the Phantoms and A7s aged, and the cost of vast numbers of Tomcats became more daunting, the US Navy looked for another type of aircraft. McDonnell Douglas, who manufactured the F-4, were well aware of the Navy's needs and set out to look for an economic multi-role answer to the problems. For over 40 years, the McDonnell name had been catering for the Navy's needs. The Navy's first jet fighter, the Phantom 1, built by the company, first flew during World War II. The Phantom 1, which was McDonnell's first design to go into production, was considered a major achievement for its time. And clearly, the Navy were impressed with the company's ability to work within the demanding requirements of carriers, which are vastly different from Air Force requirements. A vastly updated version of the Phantom, combining the same shape with more powerful engines, was the Banshee. This aircraft, shown here flying in front of a Phantom 1, was an unqualified success. The manufacturer's second production design really did hit the mark and confirmed their reputation. Its arrival was timely, because in the Korean conflict, it offered aircraft carrier commanders an extremely powerful ground attack weapon. Over 900 Banshees were produced at St. Louis and saw McDonnell well on its way to becoming a world leader in naval fighter design. McDonnell's next offering was a single-engined plane with a swept wing. Slightly underpowered at first, the design nevertheless went into successful mass production as a fighter and a reconnaissance aircraft. Its arrival brought with it the beginnings of naval use of guided missiles. The St. Louis Company's crowning achievement was the F-4 Phantom II. Over 5,000 were produced for both naval and air force requirements. The 25 years of attention to the unique problems of the Navy had paid off for McDonnell, who were now prosperous enough to acquire the giant, long-established Douglas Company. In the late 1970s, McDonnell Douglas turned its energies to serving the Navy's latest need. MacAir had had some design and financial involvement in Northrop's F-17 project, and thought the Cobra's potential was so great that they set out to isolate and eliminate the few significant bugs in the package. Provided in two versions, fighter and attack, it could well fulfill the Navy's requirements. The company took the F-17's basic layout and with their vast naval experience modified the design. For Navy use, it had to provide folded wings to be accommodated in the limited space of a carrier. More range, more powerful engines, and a totally upgraded state-of-the-art cockpit, which would sit in a completely redesigned front section, would be incorporated in the new aircraft. There were thousands of modifications. New forward sections and wings were to be built at McDonnell's St. Louis plant, but the manufacturing of the bulk of the fuselage and fin were to be at Northrop's Hawthorne factory, on the jigs made to be used on the F-17 project had it gone ahead. Thus, two great aviation companies, interestingly enough both relative latecomers, neither in existence much before World War II, came together in a combined effort to produce the aircraft. Here, a pilot enters the advanced flight simulator, which will give accurate indications of the aircraft's performance in a variety of situations, even before the design is fully manufactured. You can see the improvements in the displays added to the basic F-17 cockpit in what is only a matter of a few years. The navalized F-17, retitled the F-18 and given the name Hornet, steadily progressed in development and the prototypes went into production. the latest materials were used to provide strength and lightness to increase the overall performance of the aircraft. Naval aviation requirements for planes that might be flying from an aircraft carrier anywhere in the world are very specific, and components for the new type were individually subjected to thorough testing. Here, naval officers working with McDonnell engineers view a mock-up of the first F-18 Hornet. Made of wood rather than production materials, this model gives a good indication of what naval crews might expect of the real thing. As a bonus for the program, MacAir had on hand the YF-17 prototypes. These were regularly flown, giving service and company pilots an opportunity to experience flight characteristics similar to, if less advanced than, those of the new aircraft, itself still yet to be put together on the St. Louis production line. One thing the Navy insisted on in the reborn Northrop design was a vastly more robust undercarriage to take the devastating effect of bringing tons of high-tech to a sudden stop on a moving carrier deck in a matter of feet. Here, the totally modified forward section, with McDonnell's wings, both produced at St. Louis, are brought together in preparation for mating with the fuselage, manufactured in California and flown in on an Air Force freighter. Each section is completely assembled as a module or plane set. Although McDonnell refined the plane so that the Navy would adopt it, clearly Northrop had played a major role in the aircraft's production. The similarity of the F-18 to the basic Cobra design leaves little doubt about how well thought out the F-17 actually was. Pipes, wires and joints from California are perfectly matched to their partners produced in Missouri, all coming together in a superb fighter aircraft that was to fill at least two Navy needs. The first of the 20 pre-production F-18s rolls out of the McDonnell Douglas production plant. Service representatives and other dignitaries mingle, examining the born-again fighter design, truly a phoenix from the ashes, that it is hoped will satisfy the needs of the Navy and the Marines, both in a fighter and attack versions. Taking to the air for the first time, the F-18 handled perfectly. Here, the heavily reinforced undergear, a vastly more substantial component than that needed by its F-17 forebear, is lowered. Before any fighter can go into service, the pre-production models are put to and beyond their limits. Each one of the 20 pre-production aircraft will be given a specific role in which to examine the ways of the Hornet. The maneuverability of some aircraft will be tested at high speed. Others will be dedicated to testing weapon carrying and release, and another to the difficult and demanding task of spin testing. In actual fact, the Hornet had excellent tendencies in the spin situation, and control was easily regained. The modern fighter pilot has the assistance of computer advice on a visual display to tell him what to do in disorienting situations. Another of the initial 20 found itself in the hands of the Air Force, where, looking quite bedraggled and sorry for itself, it was subjected to bad weather conditions in an artificial environment. Extreme cold and extreme heat would be applied to the aircraft to check for the slightest flaw in the design. Back in naval hands, one of the test F-18s, all of which were identified by blue or red markings on the wingtips and nose section, was subjected to carrier landing and takeoff procedures on a land base. Landings similar to those which would be required on a carrier are experienced. The most dramatic phenomena can be seen in this test series. Catapult takeoffs and high angle of descent landings put the prototype F-18s through their paces. In heavy crosswinds, the computer-controlled surfaces struggle to keep tons of high-tech travelling in a straight line. On the 30th of October 1979, the first F-18 carrier landings were made, with Lieutenant Commander Dick Richards at the controls. Prototype number 3 was to be subjected to continual testing in a sea environment, with constant takeoffs and landings, touch and goes. Eventually, the ultimate challenge, carrier landing at night. The prototype F-18s were put through their paces and gave an insight into what the Navy could expect from its new economical high-performance fighter, and, by inference, from the intended new attack aircraft. The combination of McDonnell's clear understanding of naval requirements with the original genius behind Northrop's clever evolution of sophisticated lightweight fighters was clearly impressing the Navy as a potent answer to its problems. Interestingly, the excellence in the overall design was such that it never became necessary to make separate fighter and attack variants. The plane provided sufficient flexibility to accomplish both roles, negating the need to duplicate the aircraft in the all too limited space on board the aircraft carrier. By November 1980, the Navy was ready to take delivery of the first F/A-18. With the usual ceremony that accompanies such major events, the Hornet goes into commission. For the commanding officer of the first squadron to receive the F/A-18, Captain J.W. Partington, this is obviously an occasion of some considerable pride. This is one of the first two-seat versions to be produced, to be used for crew familiarization in the ways of handling what was fast becoming one of the most important aircraft in the Western defense. The Marine Corps' first plane was celebrated with equal occasion, as this service took delivery of the aircraft that was going to replace its aging F-4 Phantoms. Some of the squadrons now using McDonnell's latest technology can trace their heritage back to a time when McDonnell themselves were a mere producer of aircraft parts. It was likely that Flying Leathernecks would have as much success with their aircraft as they had with McDonnell's legendary Phantom II. Soon the F/A-18 was to go into full deployment with both services. Marine pilots alongside Navy with identical aircraft, although the roles that they perform may vary greatly depending upon the mission requirements. The Hornet was not to be totally confined to carrier use. Reversing the failure of its F-17 predecessor, it was to successfully win many overseas orders. CF-18 Canadian Hornets were ordered by a nation that had previously owned both Northrop and McDonnell aircraft. Canada had long preferred the provision of two engines over one when flying in harsh environments. Here, a two-seat CF-18 flies over Canadian airspace. If you look carefully under the cockpit, you'll see a clever Canadian innovation. The lower surface is painted with a black shape, which is designed to confuse enemy pilots in a dogfight. At speed, an opponent might not be able to tell whether he's looking at the top or bottom of the Hornet. Here, Air Commodore Rosa, the officer in charge of the Australian procurement of F-18s, flies a US Navy Hornet. Australia purchased the F/A-18 as a replacement for its aging Mirage fighters, and much of the aircraft's components were to be built on the island continent, where, except for the prototypes, it was also to be assembled. This is one of the early Australian planes being loaded into a C-5A transport in St. Louis. Consumed by the C-5A, it is transported across the Pacific to Australia, where it will act as a pattern for 75 other aircraft. High-tech fly-by-wire, the benefits of the twin-engine concept, and the extra hardiness built into an aircraft for the rigours of naval aviation all come together in one superior model that will represent the Royal Australian Air Force's front line of defence for many years to come. Another nation to invest heavily in the F-18, after it had bested the F-16 in a fiercely fought competition, was Spain, which had then recently become a member of NATO. This must have been a matter of particular significance and a source of satisfaction to Northrop and McDonnell as they combined to enjoy the export sales that had been denied the F-17. After a difficult start, only narrowly losing to the F-16, the Cobra, evolving into the Hornet, has arrived. Not only is it a winner in its originally perceived task, it is also a winner in the hardest of all fighter roles, the Navy fighter. In any part of the fighter spectrum, the FA-18 is a true winner. A great